We have reached Jewar. This was a good around 45-50 kilometers of a ride. Truly loved it. The experience was amazing. And we are now just heading to Starbucks. Debrief on the ride because we swapped motorcycles. I ride a Tiger, he rides a V-Strom. We just swapped it and let's see what Puneet has to say about the Tiger. And I'll share my feedback about the V-Strom 800D. Let's get a Starbucks coffee.
Okay, so how was the ride, man?
It was brilliant. It was amazing. It was fun.
You were riding the Tiger,
it's
right?
Meant to be, yeah.
Yeah.
I have before.
So what speeds were you clocking?
I have clocked till 160.
160? Okay, I thought I was riding hard. So I also went till 165. But yeah, I didn't go beyond that. I was a little afraid because it's not my bike. But I loved riding the V-Strom. Puneet has recently bought the bike. He bought it about a month ago. Month and a half, right? Ridden around 1,400 odd kilometers. So I just wanted to, you know, discuss with you how you're feeling with the motorcycle as of now. But before we get into that, let's maybe just do a little bit of understanding of what motorcycles have you ridden in the past.
Okay.
What was your previous motorcycle before the V-Storm? What were you riding before that?
It was a 200cc Bajaj RS200.
Oh,
so it's a big jump, I would say.
So direct from a 200cc single
to 800cc double,
that's quite a jump, man. But that in one way also says a little bit about how easy this motorcycle is to ride.
Because the first time I did a test ride, and my first question was, first of all, I was very skeptical it would be top heavy, given its weight is around 230 kgs and 20 liter fuel tank. Because I tried the F850 GS and it felt very top heavy, BMWs.
Yeah.
And I was looking somewhere in the budget of 10 to 15 max. So when I sat on it, it was full tank, which I didn't knew. And my first question to the dealership was, is the tank empty? Because I don't feel any top heaviness. which surprisingly to me, he answered by turning on the key and I'm like, okay, the bar is full.
Oh.
And he said, take a test ride. He specifically gave me a longer route and there was some off-road section in it. And he was like, please do try the off-road section and you will get to know why I'm asking you to do that. And I was afraid maybe because it's the first time big bike off-road and that to a dealership bike.
Okay.
And I tried it within the first few seconds and I was like, I want more of this section. It's so easy to ride on off-road also, and on-road too, it's amazing.
So there was no part of the motorcycle that was scaring you when you were riding?
No, not at all. Except for the power initially, just you get the hang of it.
If
you
haven't ridden, clutch and everything.
Right? Because the power comes a little easier. The torque is quite good in the lowdown. So apart from that, if you haven't ridden any big motorcycles before, maybe it might scare you initially, the power, but you'll get the use
maybe
of
I
it.
Think 5-10 minutes, I think.
You'll get used to it. Because I had ridden it, so it wasn't scary, I would say. But the only thing where I was afraid of, was taking out on the off-road, but once I took it and I was like, I can just go more and more.
One interesting thing that you mentioned, that when the dealer gave you the motorcycle, the tank was full, the test ride vehicle. That really happens. But like you mentioned that you were considering options between 10 to 15 lakhs.
Yeah.
Now all of us know that this bracket 10 to 15 lakh adventure touring motorcycles. Now we also have the Honda Transalp.
I tried the Honda Transalp when I was in Bangalore.
First of all, did you consider it?
I did consider
it. And what all other bikes did you consider beyond the Transalp?
I started with 600cc from Versys. And then I realized Versys I might outgrow soon. And given parents won't allow to switch to another bike once I take Versys for another 5 years. So I wanted something where I won't easily outgrow also, but something where I can go off-roading also. Versys I can't take off-road easily.
Okay.
So next best option were either Transalp, Suzuki V-Strom, and then either the Tigers, which the new 2024 lineup which has come, the GT variant or the Rally variants.
Okay.
Rally variant was out of the budget. GT was again coming little above the budget. My budget was initially somewhere around 10-12 max, and with all the accessories, 15 I wanted to close everything.
Okay.
So that's where Tiger went off the charts. I wanted something easy maintenance, where the parts are pocket friendly. So Japanese is the way to go, or at least what I've heard of it. So which reduced the option to Transalp and Suzuki. Initially, I didn't want to go with either of them because of the tube tires. I was really scared of having a tube tires in my bike.
Yeah.
But because I had no other options, I tried the Transalp when I was in Bangalore. I rode it with a pillion, I rode it without pillion. I liked the bike, but I didn't feel that connection with the bike.
As in, I mean, was the power not enough? But technically,
no, power was good.
Power is actually more than the
more than
this,
90
it has
BHP.
90 odd
yes,
BHP, right?
Around 7 BHP more.
Yeah.
So, it's not about the issue with the power. It's how the bike connects with you, how you feel with riding the bike. So that I didn't feel with the bike, which the moment I sat on this bike and it just put a smile on my face. It just put a huge grin on my face and I was like, hey.
That speaks a lot of things about the 800DE motorcycle, because normally we feel a connection with a motorcycle that has more power. Right?
Yeah, power is
this
not
is 10 BHP lesser.
But, 5-7 BHP
but still, you kind of connected with this motorcycle,
yeah, it
more than the Transalp,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, exactly.
Any glaring disadvantage that you saw in the Transalp or felt? I mean, beyond the feel, anything that was very, very obvious that other owners can also maybe look at as a point of elimination in the Transalp?
If we are very strict on the budget, slightly costlier Transalp, but nothing, everything is par to par with this.
Okay.
As much as I've heard the reviews and with my experience, because I didn't get to ride for a very long time, this I got a longer period, that test ride, Transalp I couldn't.
Okay.
And one more thing, because I was shifting here and then the showroom would have been very far for me, the Honda, which is in Gurgaon.
Okay. Yeah, yeah.
So taking that, because everything else is same, so not much big of a difference. It's
okay.
All about, I would say, what connects with you more or what suits you better when you're riding it.
When you got the bike home, how much money did you shell out? What is the exact amount? On-road price?
Little less than 12 lakhs, somewhere around 11.9 something.
For an 800cc motorcycle, I think right now how the market is changing, that's a decent amount.
That's quite a decent amount, and given if you're going to keep the bike for 5-7 years and you're properly going to ride it and explore it, I think it's like, what do you say, shotgun type thing, like bullseye.
Because previously in that 800cc segment you had to spend around 14.5-15. What all accessories have you gotten installed? I see that you have the Park Busters, which is my favorite accessory to start off with, right?
So far what I've gotten is the Park Busters, Hepco & Becker crash guard, Hepco & Becker tank guard, and the sun guard from Hepco & Becker. The center stand also from Hepco & Becker, and then RAM phone mount, which we have removed so far. And apart from this, there are few more accessories which are yet to come. One is tubeless conversion with the Outex. There is GV windshield which is waiting at the dealership. I'm yet to install it. And a handlebar risers. For my height, it feels like I'm slightly slouching towards the front side. It's not that it's not comfortable. You'll get used to it after 1 or 200 kilometers. But still, I would prefer a bit more relaxing. And so a handlebar riser is a good option for me there. And some aux lights. Maybe later on some luggage options too.
Very good. So how much money have you spent till now?
Around 1.5 to 2 lakhs on just for these accessories only, protection basic accessories.
Okay, so around 40 is what you have spent on the bike so far, right?
Yeah.
To get Everything. It in its
Including
current state,
things,
right?
Yeah, 40 you can say.
When I was riding the V-Strom, I didn't feel that it requires handlebar risers. It's Puneet's personal preference to get one.
Yeah, specifically for me.
Yeah, because I didn't feel the need of handlebar riser. It's very comfortable. The riding triangle is absolutely spot on. As far as I am concerned, this being a Suzuki, it's not loaded with features like you would expect a 13 or a 14 lakh motorcycle to be. But I think whatever features are there, where they are very functional, like any Japanese brand, they are favoring function over form. So I just want to give you a brief run through of how the instrument cluster looks like and what are the features on offer. So Puneet, can you just switch it on and let us know?
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
So first of all, I'd say it's a very crisp and clear display. Even in the bright sunlight, you can see absolutely everything very clearly. So first thing is the traction control here. You have three modes off. Either the gravel
mode.
This
is the gravel mode.
Yes.
Okay.
This G is gravel mode. The traction control goes to gravel mode off 1, 2, and 3.
So
3
okay.
is the most intrusive. 1 is the least intrusive.
So if you want to do all those slides and skid turns, then G is
either
the mode.
Either G
right?
or off.
What is SDMS?
Suzuki drive something. It's basically the power modes. So A is the most aggressive, B is linear, and C is the most lenient power mode. You get full power in all three modes. The only difference is the way the power is delivered.
Okay.
So it's more throttle opening and less power.
Okay.
That
okay.
way. And the last would be the ABS. 2 is the most intrusive. Then there's 1 and then there's off.
So all these can be operated.
Off
using
is only for rear.
Using these
two
switches,
right? Just the mode and up and down.
That's one of the most simplest switch layout that I have seen.
Most practical also.
Yeah, most practical also. What else
Unlike
can you expect?
Unlike the Hondas where the horn and the
That is a mess. I mean, that feels so unintuitive, you know, getting used to the horn.
Yeah, exactly.
But the number of buttons is a delight to see. I've seen bikes having a mess in terms of the button layout. The Tiger has
the Ducati and the Tiger both. They have
Tiger and Ducati are still fine. But have you ridden the Harley Davidson Pan America?
I haven't, but I have seen the switch case.
So there are around seven or eight switches here, seven or eight switches on the right side of the handlebar. You get totally confused. Even there's a music button.
Africa
I don't know what
Twin
level
is
there.
Very
Even the new Africa Twin has
but
a lot of buttons.
The bike is lovely. The instrument cluster is very simple and easy to read out as compared to the Honda Trans-L. There's straight up the speedometer here, fuel gauge is simple, the gear indicator is simple, the quick shifter.
Okay, that's QS is quick shifter.
Yes,
okay,
quick shifter on or off. Mm-hmm. And then you have the different modes down there. You have the odometer, two trip meters and fuel gauge.
So now maybe tell us about the seat height. What's the seat height? I think it's
855.
855.
Yeah, it's 855.
And what's your height?
5'8".
So maybe if you can get on the motorcycle and
it's
show
very
us.
It's easy to get on. And almost I can flat foot, as you can see, both the feet.
Is it flat foot? No.
This part is very...
not able to completely flat foot, right?
About to, almost.
Yeah. I think one more thing that works very well is this narrow waistline.
Yes,
that
exactly.
Allows easy. Somebody like you also to almost flat foot the motorcycle. But for 5'8", 5'7", I think this is manageable.
Easily manageable. Just you have to get used to the weight a little bit in the initial part, the initial days of the bike. But rest all you can easily manage the bike. It's nothing as hard.
So while the seat height is 855mm and we saw that you were almost
able to flat foot.
And it was comfortable to you. What sort of cushioning does the seat provide? Because when I was riding, I felt that
it's
was much more better.
It's absolutely fabulous, I would say. Even compared to Tiger, it's absolutely fabulous.
Yeah. The Tiger seat feels a little stiff, lacks maybe a little bit of cushioning with the 900 series. This one is very plush, what I felt.
Even the suspensions are plush, so that is a cherry on top, I would say. So even the room which you get here, and even it's not a split seat, it's a single seat, but that curvature just fits your butt properly. It's very forthcoming for you. I didn't even like the seat in the Trans-L. It's good for long distance, but it's a little bit stiffer. But with the Trans-L, the pillion seat area is a little bit longer.
What is the ride experience like? I have ridden the bike today and I loved it in terms of it being a super smooth motorcycle, very tractable, very linear power delivery, and when you try to push it,
it goes in any power,
and at the same
band,
time
goes.
The type of vibration dampening that they have used,
it's
so
amazing.
For a twin this is very smooth. And one thing that I remembered is that before buying the Tiger, I had the Versys 650 for almost 3 years. That's also a twin cylinder motorcycle,
yes,
by
exactly.
The way.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
Parallel twin.
And the amount of vibrations on that motorcycle, although it is considered one of the smoother motorcycles, but that feels very rough in, you know, when you compare it to this one. So for a twin also, this is feeling much more smoother than the Versys 650. That struck, I mean, even when I was riding it at 160 plus.
So they have done something as counterbalancer shafts.
Okay.
To for both the engines, which makes it really, really smooth, which I think you have felt so far, which you are talking about.
So basically there are 3 points where you normally feel vibrations. Handlebars, there were zero vibrations. Tank, zero vibrations. And just a little bit of vibes that I could feel was on the foot pegs. Yeah.
That too, if you go above 5,000 or 6,000.
Achha, one more thing that I was seeing was when I was pushing it above, I don't know what was that RPM limit, 5,000 or 6,000, it starts blinking.
That I have set personally. You can set the rev limiter range.
Okay.
So that something which I set when the bike was new, so that I don't push it beyond 6,000.
Okay.
And I haven't changed it yet. So after
because
6,000,
I was getting
it starts
worried.
Blinking.
I thought maybe it's
from
the company that you don't have to push beyond that.
You can manually change it. Yeah. You can manually.
That's
change
why I was not pushing it even hard. Maybe I would have touched 180.
No, you can.
That's good. Anyways, one thing that I feel doesn't look very good on the motorcycle, and that's my personal opinion, is the way the exhaust is designed. Have a look at this exhaust, man.
Exhaust-wise, adventure bikes, I would love the new Tiger 2024s, which is very slim and very tucked in. Tiger 1200s. This is a bit chunkier, I would say. This is very, very silent exhaust. It's like there is no exhaust only there.
It's like characterless.
Exactly.
So
I would say characterless.
I mean, not on negative. You won't feel the exhaust. When you grow into this whole segment of adventure touring, you see that the twins have that throaty exhaust, which has a lot of
you
character.
You will hear that throaty exhaust once you're in a closed room or.
You don't call it throaty. You don't call that throaty.
No, you can hear it right now also. The only thing is while riding, you won't hear it. It's very silent while riding.
Yeah. When I was parking the motorcycle here, when we parked at Starbucks, I came from somewhere there and parked it, you know, right on the grass. Even while crawling, when I started the motorcycle, it was super silent. It's a motorcycle in the silent mode. That's what I felt. So I'm not
easy
sure what
to take out of the garage in the night.
Exactly. So it will not disturb anyone. They have not done a great job in terms of designing it. It's totally black. From the side angle, it doesn't look like an exhaust of a 13 lakh rupee motorcycle. That's my problem. I really wanted this motorcycle to have cruise control. Tubeless tires and cruise control is something that everyone is literally crying for.
Rode the Tiger and I was enjoying the cruise.
So you put
control.
It on cruise?
Yeah.
Okay, what speed were you cruising at?
120-130 I have cruised it, and it was very easy. And
cruise control does not mean that you have to lift your hand off the handlebar. You just have to keep it. You just don't have to keep it.
Yeah, it doesn't strain your hand.
Exactly.
At least even as a optional from Suzuki side would have been a great thing. I mean, if you pay and else the price goes up.
There are aftermarket options internationally that are available because this has ride by wire.
Yeah.
So technically, it can be done. Any motorcycle
it
that
can
has
be done, they could have done it.
Yeah.
If they can put a quick shifter, they could have done either tubeless tires or at least the cruise control thing.
I understand their logic of not giving tubeless tires because the tubeless spoke rims, the cross spoke wheels, typically in such motorcycles
takes
cost around
up,
1.1 to 1.2
lakh. They could
have
given it as optional rims. Like Himalayan might be launching it or something like that. So
I'm not sure Himalayan rims would be a good idea on this. But maybe you can get the rims that Triumph offers for the Tiger, something like that. Is that possible?
With the dealership.
Okay.
So we'll have to check with that. So if the brake disc hub and everything else fits, you can swap it. If not, then you'll have to swap everything, the whole assembly with it. Will be an expensive thing. Easier thing is you do the Outex and.
Outex costs around 20,000?
15,000 to 20,000.
15,000 to 20,000. Because I also used that in my previous motorcycle, Tiger 800. What about the heating? Because I have felt some heat even on the
compared to the right side, on the right foot. A Japanese, there is a heat, especially in the traffic, you will feel the heat coming up, but not as much as a Triumph or Ducati.
Yeah.
Ducati will roast you like anything.
Yeah.
So nothing as such, it's manageable, even though when it goes about 108, 109 degrees, still manageable, but would still recommend something on the calves, like you put a jeans on at least.
Why recommending jeans, guys? Wear proper riding gear. We are riding in a very sultry weather in Delhi NCR. It's almost
but
like 40 degrees
complete
Celsius.
Gears.
We are in complete gears. Have a look. This is our complete riding gear, touring gear setup that we are wearing. And why I was surprised was that the motorcycle was showing an engine temperature of around 84 degrees Celsius.
Oh, and the fan turns on quite early. The thing is that it tries to manage the heat.
I observed that when you bought this for the first time in front of me, the fan was turning on very, very quickly. My Tiger has a 2-minute delay, after which it turns on the fan. But 83 degrees Celsius, still I was feeling some sort of a warm air blast coming from the engine area.
It's hotter there
even after I am wearing proper adventure touring shoes, which have some heat insulation. My pant also has some heat insulation.
Okay, I haven't. Because I've rode it in jeans also, going from here to Delhi in the peak traffic.
Okay.
Initially when the bike was new, there was heat, but after the first service, everything has subsided.
Any other thing that you feel is, which has maybe disappointed you, if that is too harsh of a term, maybe that has not been in line with your expectations after 1.5 months? I know right now you're still in that
nothing
phase,
is such,
right, of getting a new bike.
Coming from because RS200 was a sportier bike, and I have ridden the Triumphs, I've ridden the BMW and little
when
bit
you test
of
rode them, right?
Yeah. Test ride, and the Versus and everything. I was expecting a bit more brake bite, not as sharp as a sporty bike or as Triumph Tiger. It's adequate for off-roading, but for touring or when you're going touring or highway riding, it needs bit more effort
power
in the liver.
Okay. Brand calipers are they using?
Nissan,
right?
Nissan 2-pot calipers. So they could have used the 4-pot calipers, I would say.
Yeah, that is one.
But
and
made of
the thing is that the previous generation Tigers also had Nissan. the brake at that time was okay. Now in the new Tigers, they have put in the Brembo brake calipers. So that
Brembo
has
Stylema is too much, I think.
Yeah.
Brembo M40 would have done the job perfectly.
Anyways, that the Brembos have made a huge improvement. The Ducatis also have that Brembo thing.
I've tried some off-roading on it. Feels inspiring. With some skills, I'm also upskilling myself. So I think it would be a really, really lovely bike to go with. One thing is, I didn't like the windshield. There's a lot of wind blast.
Yeah.
At least for my height, not as much
the
as you would have.
The size of the windshield, guys. I mean, if you can look at it, this is
properly for rally.
This is maximum. I think the length is what, around 15 centimeters, 15 to 20 centimeters, maybe 20 centimeters, and it's starting way above the headlight as well.
It's on the top position.
Yeah.
Even it's in the top.
This
position.
Is the topmost position.
Yeah. This is the topmost position.
So this is ridiculous in terms of riding on the highway. You will get a lot of wind blast and. Maybe you saw that when I was riding. So this definitely needs an upgrade. I think you have already ordered.
I have already upgraded
one from GV, right?
Yeah, GV.
So that will make life much more, you know, quieter on the highway.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. What about these headlights? For some people, they look like an eyesore. They think this is not. This does not look good. But some people have their taste.
Like
they like
the look.
It.
I like the look quite a lot. It makes it really look an off-roady look and rally type look. I'll have to use a aux light with them.
Okay.
They are really not.
So that is another thing that you
either,
have to invest
yeah,
on.
Yeah, exactly. Either you use it with the high beam continuously, but that also straight, it's fine. Wide beam, it's very, very light. So with going on a highway or on a street, unless it's completely dark, those headlights are useless.
The mileage?
Oh, the mileage.
And the tank range. So, I mean, mileage is not very important when you're spending so much on a bike. I think tank range is
it
much
is
more
in
important.
India, it seems.
But tank range, I mean, 20 liter tank, how many kilometers will this go?
400 kilometers it will go complete.
Okay. Depending on how you ride, right?
No, you ride it rough also, you will get a 350. It on a highway, it gives a
so that is not
high
even
20
man.
Mileage, high 20.
350 is not even 20 kilometers per liter.
It's, yeah, little less than, it's around 18.
Isn't that too less for a Suzuki, Japanese, two-cylinder motorcycle?
It's, I've gotten it with a mix riding, mostly.
But I think
riding.
The motorcycle is also new. Was that in the before the first service that you got less than 350?
Even right now, so right now I'm getting 20.9, 20, around 20-21, something like that with the mix riding. But mostly my riding is in the city condition, so I get around 18 to 20. You go on highway and you get around 27, 28, even 30, 32 also.
Okay.
With a constant speed, or even you're pushing it 100 and 120, you get a mileage of around 28, 29. Which is really, really good, I would say, for an 800cc and getting around 28 to 29. But you're never always on the highway. So mixed riding condition, you'll get around 20 to 22.
So the average is around 22. That's a safe assumption, right?
Yeah.
If you're doing touring, a mix of minor off-roading city traffic and
absolutely.
80% highways.
So far, I'm also getting around 21 also.
Okay.
20.
And how much did the first service cost you? In the first service, you don't do a lot of work. It's like basic stuff, checking, right?
Changing the oil, cleaning the chain, oil filter. 3.9 liters of oil, if I'm not wrong.
Yeah,
And cleaning and waxing and everything. So around 8.5 to 8.7 is what they quoted, what I got.
Really?
Yeah.
8.5 to 8.7?
Yeah.
Isn't that too much for a first service?
This is for everything, even after 6
months. See, why I am saying that is because I got that 1000 kilometer service done on my Triumph for around 5.5 from the showroom.
Okay.
So that's why I'm surprised, because Triumph is a triple cylinder motorcycle. Typically with, you know, the increase in cylinders and all that stuff, Triumph is also considered a much more expensive brand in terms of maintenance compared to Suzuki. So I'm surprised. What did they charge you for? What was the labor charge in that? Out of 8,500 rupees.
I have to check.
Oil would be around 3,500 typically. And I was charged maybe around 2,000 rupees as labor charge. Nothing else was changed in the first service. Everything was just checking and everything. Maybe like 2 hours spent. So I remember it's 5.5.
I also got all the accessories installed in the first service only, but that was prepaid at the time of delivery only. Honda NX500 is charging around 5 or 6, something like that. So
5,000 and 6,000 for the first service
CC,
is still
for
fine.
500cc.
See, the CC is not the thing. The thing is that in the first service, not many things are done.
That is true.
If they're charging 8,500 for that service, then when is the next service due? What is the service
every
interval?
Every 6 months from the date of delivery. Same with Honda, same with Suzuki these days.
Really?
Yeah, every
6,000
or
6 months you have to.
Yeah. It's not like the Triumph once in a year thing.
And what is the kilometer?
6,000 or 6 months. whatever is. Oh,
this is crazy, man. This is like in the Benelli territory. I used to have a Benelli sometime back.
Yeah, yeah,
6,000.
Yeah. Same Kawasaki, same all Japanese are going with the same thing. All Chinese are going with the same thing. It seems these days. They've made it a trend.
So
remove the tube tire. Remove, give tube tires with everything. Put everything with every 6 month of cycle. Prices are going up with the servicing. I would say inflation hitting.
So why would I buy a Suzuki? I mean, this is driving me nuts. I mean, why would I buy a Suzuki? See, my logic of buying a Suzuki would be reliability and easy maintenance.
But reliability is still
that
there.
Is there. I agree. But if you have to spend 8,000 or 7,000 rupees every 6 months on the service, that means you are spending around 16,000 to 17,000 rupees in a year.
Once in a year, yeah.
Right, and if you ride say around 15,000 kilometers in the year, mm-hmm. then you are doing away with your set of tires as well. I think nothing is available. Good tires, dual sport sort of tires.
Karoo Street, 35,000. Even 36 to 40.
Yeah. So let's
dealers
assume 35.
Are 40 actually.
Yeah. So this is a very important point, guys. I'm saying 35,000 for tires, bare minimum, plus around 16,000 for service.
Once a
that
year.
Is 50.
With chain sprocket. If you're riding
and
harsh.
Every 20,000 odd kilometers, if you are really pushing it hard, chain sprocket also goes. 15, so that 15,000-16,000.
Yeah.
So that makes it around what? 67,000 plus an insurance.
Yeah.
Insurance maybe would for your bike 20, would be around 22. Right now it is high, but after the first year it will come down considerably.
22.
So I think it should be around 11-ish. I paid 13,000 for the insurance of my Tiger after 1 year.
Okay.
I'm just giving an example. The first year when I bought the motorcycle, the Tiger, the insurance cost was 30,000. In the
even that
in
is
the
expensive
price.
That has gone up. I have paid around 40,000 for the insurance,
so that is another topic, whether you get the insurance directly from the dealer. They will charge you a bomb. You give them a competitive quote, you will save money. That's what I did. They gave me a quote of 47,000. I got it done in 30. So maybe you could have saved money. That's a separate point, but what I'm looking at is maybe an 80-85,000 of expense.
You'll have to take it out.
Maintenance. And we are not
easily
even factoring in
petrol. Exactly.
We are not factoring in accessories that you will install. That's a given. I mean, you are getting
plus
into this.
Plus the touring, whatever
expenses
you'll spend.
And
yeah,
all.
Exactly.
So, even with a Suzuki, I think, apart from petrol, you are looking at around 80,000 rupees per year.
Easily.
With tires, insurance,
if you change the tires, chain
sprocket, and service. Which is a bomb. 6 months, I am still not able to digest it. I'm sorry. What did you feel, for example, riding the Tiger today? So because that was one of the bikes that you were considering.
Yeah.
Was maybe out of your budget.
Quite out of your budget.
But what did you feel? If money was not a constraint, would you get that or this? Just a hypothetical question.
If money is not an issue, I'd go for BMW.
That's fine. Yeah. So.
But between the two of, I would obviously go for the triple.
Okay.
I've
were you feeling
the triple?
What was good? I mean, the power delivery.
First thing is I like the triple engine, especially with the T plane.
Mm-hmm.
You get a good torque with the twin character,
mm-hmm.
and then the triple.
So no need to praise in front of me. I mean, you can also.
No,
talk
no,
about
I really love it.
Okay.
I've ridden it. I was considering the Rally, but only because of the budget issue, I came down looking at Transalp and E-Storm.
Okay.
And apart from the engine, I would say the suspension is bit more better quality, little top heavyish. YB, I would want this smoothness in Tiger if that's ever possible.
Then I think you should have ridden the Tiger 800. That was super smooth.
Oh, I have ridden it.
That's smooth. For all of you who are looking for a middleweight adventure touring motorcycle, what I feel about this category right now is in 2024 with the Suzuki V-Storm 800DE and Transalp available in the market, I do not see Tiger being a very logical choice. This is simply based on the fact of the price difference between these two motorcycles. This being 13 lakhs on road and 12 lakhs, this being 12 lakhs on road and the Tiger 900 Rally Pro, which is around, the new model is even more expensive. I got it for around 16 and a half on road.
Now it's 19.
Yeah, so
Bangalore I remember is 19 and a half something.
So
like
let's
that.
Not compare Bangalore because we
Delhi
you bought
to Delhi
it from Delhi. Delhi to Delhi
a
is
maybe.
A 5 lakh difference at least, 5 to 6 lakh difference
easily,
at least.
Easily.
Now in 6 lakhs, even if you cut 1.5 lakhs for tubeless spoke wheels, that's a logical deduction, right? Still,
take another 50 for...
Still there is 5 lakh difference. Now,
cruise
would
control
you spend...
Take another 50 or 80.
Still, I mean, if you add all the stuff, why would you spend broadly 4 lakh rupees more to get a machine which is actually giving you 98%, 99% of the abilities that the Tiger would offer. Just from a financial, you know, analysis standpoint, I don't think getting a Tiger makes a lot of sense. Now, if you really love the triple or you are hell-bent on buying a motorcycle which is loaded with features, then it's a totally different call. If it's a call that is driven by...
You, I would say. Or it connects with you, then it connects with you.
It connects with you. It's driven by your heart. From a mind standpoint, I don't think it makes a lot of sense. So those are my concluding thoughts. If you have any further questions, let us know in the comment section. We'll be happy to answer them. That is it for this one. Thanks, Puneet, for helping us out.
Thanks, Jasvi.
And really insightful, you know, information that you have provided. I think it should really help the viewers here. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.